like you're looking through a telescope. You see where you're gonna be, growing, getting better. You're not the person they see. Can't be mad at the things you've been through, 'cause they built your muscle. Now you're stronger than you've ever been. They can't stop your hustle. Your faith ain't never small.
Precious Lord God.
Okay.
So you get rid of Jesus Christ, you got rid of the grace of God.
Well,
you agree with that?
We're only talking about breaking one rule. We're only talking about breaking one rule.
I'm talking about just, before Christ, couldn't nobody enter into heaven.
Okay, can I finish? Where you said, oh, yeah. You just said,
you agree with that?
You just said, right. Nobody just hears it.
So how you going to get there without it?
No, we're going to talk about grace. As though grace just came in when Christ came in only.
I can
grace
was cross there. Over
no. No, you're right. You're right.
Okay, so I'm trying to figure out where you agree.
I'm sorry. Come on. I just had to tag that one. Come on.
So I'm trying to figure out where this thing called grace fits in. Because like I said, just now said, last week, no matter what you did, grace set you free. Now today it doesn't. We're talking about breaking one law, and not specifically the law of, what was it we just said? The unforgivable one.
Blaspheming
the Holy Ghost, right? You just said any one of the 10 you break them all. So fine. So where's grace in that?
How can amen? Let me ask Joshua, Pastor Joshua. Let me ask Pastor Joshua this. Because I want to good. Hey, listen, Pastor Joshua.
Yes, sir.
How can a grace and mercy kiss?
Well, grace and mercy walk hand in hand.
How do grace and mercy kiss the law that's broken? Mm-hmm. No. How can God, holy God, how can a righteous God forgive the sinner that broke his law?
Well, there goes grace. Because the answer to that has always been grace. We're under the law of grace and mercy as opposed to the law of sin and death is what I was
taught. How can grace and that break of the law kiss?
By the shedding
of blood. By the shedding of blood.
Well, the blood was already shed.
Without that, it can't happen.
No.
Pastor?
Right.
The blood was already shed on the cross. So now we're in according to Pastor over here, it was shed for past, present, and future. Right? But after the blood was shed, because I wasn't born back then, I'm born today. And if I come to Jesus today and next week I slip up and break a rule, you're telling me I'm going to hell?
Well, see, not me. Joshua's telling you you're going to hell. He's the one to tell you you're going to hell.
I got the wrong victim. I should be talking
I'm
to
you.
I thought he said it. I'm sorry.
I didn't say it. You forget what Pastor the Future said. He said it. You got to talk to
him. Somebody said it.
Now, I want
somebody said it. If you don't repent, you're going to hell.
Okay, well, there it is. You got to repent. So that
who
means.
Who said that? I didn't say you got to repent. Joshua said he got to repent.
Well, I agree with him.
He said
I said that.
Yeah, I agree with him.
I disagree.
Well, okay, let me finish, please. Okay, because even last week we had that same the same example. Right? And someone said you would die if you were unrepentant. See, the key to this thing is repenting, right? Turn it away from the sin that you did, and that's when grace is enacted. Amen. Hang on, brother. Hang on, Pastor. Please, let me finish.
Oh, okay, I'm going to let you finish just as soon as I hit this one right quick.
All right.
Right?
All right.
I'm going to get it lead,
so,
right?
So we always, you guys, we always say, right, I don't know what it was because I had it a minute ago, but anyway, for sure, lack of better words. Right. Remember last week when I said all Christians have to do is breathe, right? Because they got no responsibility or nothing. Well, see, therein lies your responsibility.
So you went away from repentance.
No, I'm going right back to
okay,
it.
Come on.
You stepped right in it. Right. Therein lies your responsibility. All right. Therein lies the work that you got to do. You got to repent. You got to turn away from that sin, and you got to do everything to put that sin behind you and not revisit it. Right? And that's when grace steps in and says, okay, you're repenting. Okay, we're going to give you another chance. Well, hang on. I'm bringing it home now. Well, what you can't do, and this is what Paul said, is that you can't sin because you're saved and just say, oh, okay.
Okay. All right. But let me just hit that one time, right? And then I'm going to let you come, right? right? What you telling me, and leave this alone, we'll get it next time, is that, listen, the only way you can receive this salvation is if you're clean. Once you clean yourself, once you turn away from your sin, then grace kicks in and you can get it. Right? Well, grace is for sinners.
Wait. No, I didn't say it.
Oh, okay.
I didn't say it.
I said it.
I want to go back to some Pastor Joshua was saying when you was talking about you was reading Romans 10, amen. But the word is nigh thee, unto thee. Go to Deuteronomy 31 with me, if you put 30 for a minute, please.
Deuteronomy 30.
Yeah.
What is the verse?
Yeah, that's where it is. But I'm going to show you there's a difference in the two.
Well, there's different authors.
No, it's God speaking.
Two different authors wrote that.
30, right?
30?
Deuteronomy 30.
Yeah, right. And I just want to read, I'm just going to go to 10. You can read the whole thing later.
10?
Yeah, Deuteronomy 30 and 10.
Starting from 10?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
If thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to keep his commandments and his statutes, which are written in this book of the law, and if thou turn unto the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul, for this commandment which I command thee this day, it is not hidden from thee, neither is it far off. It is not in heaven that thou shouldest say, who shall go up for us to heaven and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it. Neither is it beyond the sea that thou shouldest say, who shall go over the sea for us and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it. But the word is very near unto thee, in thy mouth and in thy heart, that thou mayest do it. See, I have set before thee this day life and good and death and evil, in that I command thee this day to love the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways and to keep his commandments and his statutes and his judgment, that thou mayest live and multiply, and the Lord thy God shall bless thee and the land whither thou goest to possess it. But if thy heart turn away, so thou wilt not hear, but shall be drawn away and worship other gods and serve them, I denounce unto you this day that ye shall surely perish, and that ye shall not prolong your days upon the land, whether thou passest over the Jordan to go to possess it.
Okay.
So see, he gave them an ultimatum which they was unable to keep.
He always gave an ultimatum.
Now the difference here in Romans is the word is nigh in your mouth. If you confess and believe in thy heart, there's a difference. He gave them a command that they couldn't keep. They turned away from it. Amen?
Yep.
That was, and I mean, if we go back to 28, 29, what I'm saying, he told them, if they could have kept those commandments, they would have been blessed.
Yeah.
If they couldn't, they were cursed. And because they couldn't keep them, amen, that's where we come in with the Leviticus law and whatnot, right? The blood of Jesus. Because listen, just think about it now. If God had a really, because he kind of repented, you know, when he gave us the Leviticus law, you understand what I'm saying? Because if he had to stood on what he, you know, like if you break the least of one of these, boom, gone. Just like when Cain brought that offering there, right? You understand what I'm saying? That bloodless sacrifice?
Yeah.
Boom.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? But God turned it around because he so loved us. Mm-hmm. And what happens is we go through Deuteronomy and we go into Leviticus and we see right there, right? That we were never able to keep that law, and you know, and I mean, I'm not this Bible scholar, but I can see where you can see Jesus all the way through this here, all the way up to Isaiah and whatnot, where God kept pleading with his people, but kept making ways that we was until Jesus came on the scene. And so my point being is this here, is that if we were still even under the royal law. Then there would be no. I mean, think about it.
Okay.
Because what you're saying is this. I mean, I'm not trying to cut. Because what you're saying is this.
He's talking to me, so I'm sorry.
Well, I'm talking to everybody. I mean, you know, I mean, what I'm saying is this. If I'm just trying to use common sense here, when I didn't get.
Go ahead.
If. Go ahead. then there would have been no need for Jesus to come.
If what?
If we were able to keep these laws. And the thing is, right, it plainly says, I mean, this is enough for me, when it says that the law was a school teacher. You know, to let us know, right, that we were unable to keep this law. Mm-hmm. I don't care if there's 30,000 laws. We were unable to keep any of them. I don't care if they were man-made. The laws I'm talking about, but the laws I'm talking about is, no, I don't know about those 23,000.
So if you don't know them,
but I know the law that God's talking about. Well, see, here's the thing, Brother Joshua. You know, the one thing I watch people do, and I listen to a lot of people that have a lot of knowledge in the Word, but they try to get so hypothetical when it's plain. Believe in God. I don't know. Has God turned your life around?
Sure.
I mean, do you believe that because you believe that if you blaspheme the Holy Ghost, you're going to hell? Yes, it's a yes or no answer.
I believe the Bible. Yes, the Bible, because the Bible says that.
Okay, I've never read that.
It's in there. I read it. Go ahead.
No, I'm talking about not in the New Testament.
You should read the whole book.
Let me just say this to you, okay? You know what I'm saying? See, now what you just said, that was uncalled for.
Okay, I apologize.
No more feelings.
No, it ain't feelings.
Okay,
right?
We can't get mad.
Let me respond.
You shouldn't even throw that word out there, mad, because I just said something. That's why I just
said. Well, first of all, brother, I wasn't mad, and I would have said that to anybody. Your reasonable service and your due diligence to read the whole book and not just the New Testament. Otherwise, you would have knew that. You're a pastor. You're supposed to know that. That's why I said that. I wasn't trying to be rude. This is a theologian class. I mean, some things need to be said. You just said you didn't read it. You should have read that.
Well, you should you know something? Let me just say
that. I apologize if I offended you.
I should have said
that. I didn't mean to offend you.
I should have said I haven't read in the New Testament.
Okay, thank you.
And not only that, right? See, here's the thing when I'm trying to make, the point I'm trying to make, and then I'll be done. Mm-hmm. To me, grace negates all the laws. We're talking about the law. The law I'm talking about is the law of God, the Ten Commandments. Okay, I'm not trying to bring in all these other laws. You understand that the Pharisees wrote and they added on to the law, because I thought that's what we were talking about. Because according to my Bible, Jesus came and he fulfilled that law.
Okay.
Is there a yes or no in that?
Well, I don't know, because I don't agree.
I agree.
You
got
to ask them. You got to ask them.
Come on.
You got to ask. Pastor said something a few minutes ago, and you said, well, he was talking to the Israelites.
Huh?
I said,
remember, if you recall what I said, to the point where this brother asked me to explain it, I said it is, although this was talking to the Israelite, it was also talking to the church,
right,
but not so much.
But see, here's
I think that's what, something like that.
Yeah, which exactly.
I didn't say just to Israel.
But here's the point I'm trying to make.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Make it.
Gentiles, we...
Hebrews chapter 10.
We, the Gentiles?
Yeah.
Sin wasn't even imputed to us.
What?
Sin. I mean, these laws weren't even designated for us.
Because we was already sin.
Amen. You know what I mean? I mean, right. There was no sin imputed to us.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, so these laws couldn't have been, per se, can't come to us. That's the point I'm trying to make. Okay?
So,
right.
And for us, we really...
We come in from Acts 14.
So let me read this here. This is chapter 10 of Hebrews, right? And
but
it says,
finish, Pastor.
Why'd you let him finish, baby? I'm trying to get him to finish so I can come in. But he can't finish if you keep talking to him. But listen, chapter 10 of Hebrews says, it says, for the law,
that's right,
having a shadow of good things to come and not the very image of the thing, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the coming thereunto perfect. For then would they have not ceased to be offered, right? Because the worshiper once purged should have no more consciousness of sin. But those sacrifices, there is a remembrance again made of sin every year.
Yeah.
For it is impossible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sin. Therefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, sacrifices and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me. Mm-hmm. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin thou hast had no pleasure. Mm-hmm. Then said I, lo, I come in the volume. I come in the volume of the book, it is written of me to do thy will, O God. Above, when he said, sacrifices and offering and burnt offerings and the offering for sin, thou wouldest not, neither hadst pleasure therein, which are offered by the law. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second, by the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest standing daily ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifice, which can never take away sin. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sin forever, sat down on the right hand of God, from henceforth expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. For by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified.
So right? What was your point?
Remember, he didn't just say, by one sacrifice he hath perfected them. But he continues, says, he tell you, them. He didn't say by one sacrifice he has perfected forever them. He didn't say that, just stay there.
That are sanctified.
That are sanctified. So, yeah. So the word sanctify implies a lot.
Yeah, I know.
Them that are sanctified.
I don't even know what he's talking about.
But first of all, let me go somewhere with you with that you just brought up.
Okay.
This thing you are talking about here, it's talking about sacrifices under the law.
Yeah.
All the sacrificial things that are under the law.
Yes.
But it's not talking about the general law of God. It's talking about a specific law.
Exactly.
Sacrificial law.
Listen.
Laws concerning sacrifice.
Listen.
That's what he was talking about.
The law that concerns sacrifice also concerns sin.
Mm-hmm.
Because without sin, you don't need the sacrifice.
Mm-hmm. Not true.
It is true. You sacrifice for sin.
I beg you.
Right? Now let me get this here first.
Before you beg my pardon.
Christ,
right?
That sacrifice is one of
the. But then
sacrifice.
He says,
that's what that's talking.
And I just read it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. He taketh away the first,
right,
that he might establish the second.
Mm-hmm.
By the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Christ once and for all.
So you don't have to offer a bull. You don't have to offer a turtle dove.
What?
You offer Christ.
The Christ was sacrificed.
Yeah.
And we are sanctified through that sacrifice.
Right.
Right? And he said he had perfected forever them that are sanctified.
And I don't disagree with that.
Oh.
But what I'm saying to you, it's not talking about the entirety of the law.
It is talking about the law.
Entirety?
Yes.
The whole 603 and the whole 2013.
The blood.
He's not talking about that.
It's the blood of bulls.
It's nothing to say, either I believe it or not.
Listen,
you either believe it or you don't.
It's not talking about the entirety of it.
Come on.
It's still not talking about
the entirety. Come on. Of course it is, man. You know, this is why we need to go through this thing one verse at a time.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Come on.
I agree.
Yeah, it's been the way I was taught, and no, I didn't make it up, that I agree with him. He's talking about the law there, right? That's where I was, you know.
I got a good bathroom.
I'm wondering if you made that up.
He's talking about finding it up. And I was thinking,
I mean, did you just make that up?
I'm saying all you have to do is believe what I just said too.
No, what?
Because that's what I believe. So my belief is that this particular passage here is talking about the sacrificial law.
It is. I remember
those law we are not under.
Mm-hmm. And see what I'm saying about the blood sacrifice, right? You're talking about the blood sacrifice of a bull as opposed to a blood sacrifice of a god. So the god wins hands down. Right, but what I'm getting at is why the change? Because God established this blood sacrificial system just as he brought in this one. And he just said they're changing them. Taking away one to establish the other. So this one did not work.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I said
period.
That's why I said he took it higher.
Yeah.
It didn't change anything.
Uh-huh. So what is the higher? Is the higher faith?
What? No,
or is the higher faith?
Meaning that it makes
or is the higher
what you're able to produce. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I hear what you're
higher
saying.
Higher faith, higher than
you
what
say
I can
he's bringing up to
can I answer
a
that
higher.
Here?
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So what is the higher that you're saying he's bringing it up? Is it faith?
Listen, we're talking about the carnal stuff. Where we were talking about pools.
Right.
When we were talking about Jesus, when he's the Bible says that this when we talk about Christ, it says that it wasn't made by the will of men.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus wasn't by the will of men, but by the will of God.
The Father,
that means that he was born by the will of God.
Let me ask you a question.
So when he took that sacrifice, another word. Like my brother was asking earlier, is it mean that this sacrifice they did in the back wasn't valid? Was no good? And I'm saying that no, it's not that it wasn't good, because it did do something, because it take away sins, but temporarily,
right?
And then here where you read it here, it says something. That's why I'm talking about the English language. Where you just read here, I'm trying to point my finger on it, where he read earlier that bull sacrifices didn't take away sin.
That's right. And six.
You know? Six? Mm-hmm.
Six.
It says that, and burnt offering and sacrifices for sin thou has no pleasure. That's right. What 10:6 says. It's not six.
Okay.
You read somewhere here, it says bull offering. Okay. 11. And every priest standing daily ministering and offering
10:4.
Yeah,
no,
okay.
It's
11.
It is
10:11.
No, 10:4, you said
well,
both,
it might
right.
be in both
right.
places. Just read one.
It is not
okay,
possible
whatever. Okay,
that
for
the blood
it is
of,
not possible that
right.
the blood of bulls and of God should take away sin.
Mm-hmm.
You see how the English language put this?
Yeah.
So to me, what that's saying
that's
is that
direct contradiction.
Is that that sacrifice didn't do anything.
Yeah, that's direct contradiction.
So, no, hold on, Pastor, hold on.
Yeah, you ready to jump in.
Let me get my point before you shut it off.
Don't hit me because I'm just looking.
Well, you give me the look that I'm, look like my mama look. Like you're about to take me off. But here's what I'm saying, right? Is that the English word, the way it placed this, if someone who don't read the word read that, you would think that when it says do not take away anything, it's like it didn't do anything
work.
At all. Like, but when you read the word, it says that when they take it, they bring it off if the priest went in, if he did not offer sacrifice for himself, he would die. Because first, before he could present the sacrifice for the people, he had to present for himself. So if that sacrifice kept him from dying when he entered the Holy of Holies, then he did something. It just didn't do it completely. So that's what that's saying, although it didn't go to the full explanation in the English. When you read it here in English,
did Christ do it completely?
Yes.
Okay.
But I'm saying, but what you're reading here is as if it didn't. That's why I give the example earlier about the doctor. I said, if the doctor come to fix your car, you say he's useless, but the doctor is not useless. So then, if that shouldn't read.
It's got to read like that.
No.
It's got to.
It should not read that. Because it is not possible that the blood of bull and of goat should take away
sin. It's not possible. It only covered it.
It only covered sin.
Yeah. It didn't take it away.
Well, it says it didn't do anything, which is not saying it's covering it.
It didn't say
it
didn't do
anything. It's misleading, man.
It didn't say
anything
about covering
it. It says it doesn't do anything.
It didn't
say. That means it don't work.
What I'm saying is it should say it covers sin, but didn't take it away.
No, it don't work.
No, I think it said what it's supposed to say. This is why I said it.
That's English. I give it to that.
But this is why I said it.
If I read it in my language.
But this is why I said
it. If I read it in my language. It completely explained it.
But this is what I'm saying, right?
It makes perfect sense.
And everybody else is
language but us. You want to say
it
away.
But
listen,
we don't read it
because
in our language.
It's telling it just like it is.
You know what
right?
I mean?
Yet the God is the God of America. He's the God of Haiti. He's the God of Africa. He's the God of all the other continents. But yet they don't read the same way that the English language read it.
Because we read.
That's
we
what
read
I'm saying.
Elizabeth.
The English language mislead people.
It even reads differently in the NIV.
All I'm
sure
saying
it does.
It reads differently in NIV.
All I'm saying is that
it's impossible for the blood of bulls and of goats to take away sin, which God never meant for it to do. God never meant for it to take away sin. Well, God only meant for it to cover sin until the promise came. God had always promised that a Savior was coming, right? And they had a hope, right, that he was coming. And these things only set sin aside until the sin could be taken away. And that's what it's explaining here. See this? Yes. Right here in chapter 10, verse 1, it says this. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, a shadow. That's all it was.
That's all it was.
Okay.
It was just a shadow of what was coming.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Right? Well,
you agree with that, right?
I'll agree with that.
In Leviticus, uh-huh. all them offerings spoke of him coming.
I'll agree with that. But right? You may we say all the offerings. As long as you're talking about the offerings and the sacrifice.
So let me tell you something else, though.
Uh-huh.
Right?
That we're not on.
He walked 33 years in this earth without breaking one commandment.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's right.
You agree with that?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Right? So you know the law, mm-hmm. right, that he was under mm-hmm. did not pertain to him.
He was a God.
Listen to him.
Go ahead, man. I gotta get this out.
Come on.
Get up.
Get up.
Yes, he does.
He
was a God.
There's no
just Jesus.
You go, man.
I said a God. You know, like the Jehovah's Witnesses. I never said he wasn't. But the white one don't exist. And I'll tell you that point blank right off. Now, he was a God.
Amen. Edit that.
I will. He was a God. Okay? He already knew the deal.
Amen.
When he came here to a land where nobody knew what he knew.
Man, preach to his cousin. You preach, man. Go ahead.
Let me finish, man. He came down here.
You just don't know how happy I am to hear you, man. Speak.
Okay. He came down here to a people who don't know what he knows. He knows the end game. We don't. He's a God. He can't sin.
What'd he come for?
Well, let me finish before you start throwing stuff out there. Right?
Know, man.
He's down here to imperfect beings, his creation. Right? And you expect us to live up to what he did? The Bible says man has a sin nature. His heart is evil only continually. That means his desires are not for the good. His desires are for fleshly delights and gains and greed and all that stuff. So why is anybody down here even thinking of trying to do what Jesus did? That's not the nature of man.
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know.
But I mean, you came down here.
Me,
yeah, I know what the Bible tells you.
That he died for the ungodly.
Okay. I know what the Bible tells you.
Them creatures you're talking about.
Here's my thing, right? Because we always miss this whole path, right? From one point to the other, Jesus came and died for our sins, so now all of us have to live correct. Okay, I'm saved. And if I've sinned, okay, I'm not saved anymore or whatever, right? There's something called the road, the process. You got to walk from here to get to there where Jesus was. And you won't get there alive. You're not going to be like Jesus glorified until you pass. So there's no way, shape, or form you're going to walk this earth perfectly. That's why you got your grace. That's the only way man can make it. He can't make it no other way. And I don't care if the Savior came in here and walked us by the hand.
Man, you preaching to me, buddy.
Well, look, man, if you're listening, you might learn something.
Yeah, I did.
All right?
I did. I learned crazy. You preaching.
Yeah, okay.
You preaching.
Look, man,
I'll get you a mic.
I ain't trying to preach. I'm trying to give you a reel. All right? The reason they stopped that blood sacrifice stuff, the big man upstairs said, this thing ain't working. They just killing animals for the hell of it. You know what I mean?
So when did he learn that?
I don't know. I wasn't there.
I'm telling you.
At some point,
I'm
he got
there.
It. At some
I'm
point,
there. Okay,
when you were
there. He understood that from the beginning.
All right, then why?
You know? He understood it from beginning.
You throw that out there, right? But then my question becomes, why the game?
It's like you're looking through a telescope. You see where you're gonna be. Growing, getting better. You Can't be mad at the things you've been through, 'cause they built your muscle. Now you're stronger than you've